Hi, this is Ben from GP Adventures and the Hobby Shop Dungeon. And sometimes when I am working on the Marmoral Tomb, as I'm writing the module, I come up with topics of conversation and might either write a post or decide to make a video like here. One of the subjects that keeps popping up in conversations about old school games is the sandbox. The idea of running a campaign without this kind of adventure path, or where there is a single cast of characters that advance on an overarching story towards a definite end. And even though the player characters might come to this end of the campaign in various ways, it will eventually go there, right? And defeat the great villain or whatnot. The sandbox, by contrast, doesn't have that. Now, often, you will find gamers who generally won't have experience with that kind of campaign will say, well, that doesn't make sense because, you know, that means that in a sandbox, you will find yourself completely lost. You don't have anything to do. All the walls are white and, you know, you don't have any hooks for adventure, and the characters don't have motivations, there's no stories, and so on. And that is generally, in my experience, just not the case, right? First, that's called an excluded middle argument, you know, like basically there's one proposal and the other proposal on the opposite end, and there's nothing happening in between. That, in fact, most sandbox games happen somewhere in between those two extremes, right? And when we're talking about story and storytelling in terms of adventure path, we're talking about this from a meta game, bird's eye point of view on the game. That doesn't mean that characters in the game, in a sandbox game, don't have their own histories, their own backgrounds, their own motivations, and so on and so forth, right? So that's the first thing. Now, I wanted to talk about how to organize a sandbox. First, you know, to how to create it, so that from there we can move on later on to other aspects of the sandbox, right? So we can basically dispel some of these either misunderstandings or fears about the sandbox playstyle, right? Which used to be, in fact, the basic playstyle of the original Dungeons & Dragons game. Okay, so what do you need for a sandbox when you start and you say, okay, I'm gonna run a campaign. A sandbox, my players are in, what do I do? What do I prep, right? Well, what do you need, like, assuming we're using, you know, like Dungeons & Dragons, right? What you will need is a place where the player characters can live and retreat to from the adventure, right, to heal, to gain some measure of knowledge, to buy some supplies, sell some stuff, and so on, right? So you need basically the home base. Two, you need a main place of adventure. That's the dungeon. Like, most people would call that today the mega dungeon, but in the old rule books of first edition and the original edition of the game, they call that simply the dungeon. That's a place of evil that acts like a microcosm, an underworld, where things change. There are many, many, too many inhabitants to just wipe them out in one go. Where, you know, other going-ons in the world will gravitate around the center of evil. Think about the Temple of Elemental Evil, for instance. That's that kind of place, right? Right. And so, once we have our home base, our place of evil, of adventure, what we need is what's going on in between. And that means a wilderness map, where we have the place where the home base is. The place of adventure should generally be 1 to a few days away, so that when, well, I mean in terms of walking distance for the adventurers, so that when they make the treks between the home base and the dungeon, you will have some variations and diversity of environment, including night and day, right? at least one or two cycles of it. And from there, you just basically take an X map, you know, place your home base, your place of adventure, and then you paper the map with features, you know, mountains, forests, lakes, and some other locales of interest, which might include smaller dungeons and little petty tyrants, the tower of a wizard, any place of interest that might be visited and explored, basically. So that's the first point. Now, let's move on to, we prepped, right? Let's imagine that we prepped. We have our home base ready on paper with the NPCs. We have our places of interest in the wilderness. And we have, let's say, 1 to 3 levels of the dungeon on the surface done. With the future levels deeper, we know there are some, we haven't done them yet, right? We're essentially ready to run the game here with level 1 characters. And from there, we move on, right? We start the adventures in the town and they start exploring and all that. Now, things will happen because then you set up the environment in a way that things happen. NPCs are encoded, events happen. And so on and so forth. So the way a good sandbox in my mind is run, things happen and new possibilities of adventure spring up, not necessarily from the actions of the players, but sometimes from the actions of the players, and sometimes spontaneously because of other events that the player characters are not experiencing firsthand. The golden rule of running a good sandbox, that's roleplay the world. The players play their own characters, you DM roleplay the world, which includes all the inhabitants in the world. So sometimes, as you're answering the player characters, or in between sessions even, you might think of what's going on outside of the field of perception of the players. What's going on in the world? How is it changing between sessions? Right? What might, from there, make it into the game at some point? Would there be refugees from a nation that has been just, you know, defeated by hobgoblins next to the place where the players are adventuring? Would there be a new cult that springs up from the death of a god in your cosmic multiverse? And so on and so forth, right? So that the big things around will sprinkle into the game in contact with the player characters. That gives a feeling that the world is a living place, right? Considering the locales as well of adventure and the villains, you might want to create some type of tiers of scale for these characters or these locales, right? For instance, in the Marmoral Tomb, there's a scale of villainy, right? Well, the basic critters, goblins and stuff, in like the servants or followers of a villain do not count, right? Okay. From there, when you have a villain say that he's around, I'm just looking at my notes here. Anything that's around 4 dice or less and so on can be a very local villain, you know, he's the little chieftain of a group of kobolds or whatever, right? It's a very localized threat. That's fine for low-level characters. For greater-level characters, you might want to have several of them, right? Okay. Then that's basically like the local villain. That's just a direct threat to the adventurers as they do their thing or the place they live. Then you have the regional villain, which is much more like in the heroic, superheroic range, like it dies 5-8, right? These are villains that are in charge of mercenary companies. They have their own lairs. They can threaten potentially or disrupt kingdoms, at least, you know? And these become potentially recurring villains in the campaign. The characters might meet their henchmen several times. They might meet these villains several times including in various guises, and so on. Beyond the regional villain, you have the world villain. The world villain, that's one of the main movers and shakers of the world. This is a character like... I wanted to give a Marmoreal Tomb example, but for a local villain, I'm trying to think, you might have a character like the Hobgoblin on level 1 of the Marmoreal Tomb, which is like basically a petty Hobgoblin that enslaves others, goblins, to his own bidding to live in the remnants of the tombs of the dwarf on level 1 of the dungeon. For a regional villain, you might think of someone more like the Silted King. The Silted King is a mysterious magic user that lives in the wild and controls all sorts of forces of chaos and has contacts with the undead and so on. So and there are several characters like that. I'm just taking some quick examples. And it might become a world threat. Okay, the next tier is the world villain. And the world villain, so that's the very powerful character, mover and shaker of the world. These characters are in control of entire nations or entire networks of spies throughout the world. And so on and so forth. These might be characters like Crassus the Cambion in the Marmoreal Tomb. That is the stone giant Cambion that destroyed the settlement of the dwarf and which presently is smuggling an entire army of humanoids and giants through the wilderness to assault the Visconti in the future. And then the DM, of course, decides whether that event is triggered sometime in the campaign or not. And that depends how the party interacts with that as well. And beyond the world villain, you have the ultimate cosmic villain. You know, like those are archdevils and demons and those magic users that have grown beyond the multiverse and seek to destroy entire planes of existence and so on and so forth. Right? Gods, you know, gods of evil. These are the types of villains. So you can replicate those kinds of scales to various elements, you know, whether we're talking about lairs, whether we're talking about potential allies of the characters and so on and so forth. But it's useful in the sense that you always get a sense of the influence of character and the potential the character has in terms of development in the campaign. And you should think about that. You should think about, you know, in your dungeon or in the area around, if there are factions and potential villains and so on, how will, for instance, let's say a dungeon map, how will the dungeon map evolve in the future of the campaign? Like, if the player characters wipe out a third of the map and then they retreat, what happens? Which faction is going to take over most likely? You know, right, in terms of probabilities. Then when you are in between sessions, you decide what actually happens. But take some little notes about, you know, yeah, the cultists of Orcus might are the most cohesive group on this level and might take over if something happened to the Hobgoblins, who are much weaker, and vice versa, right? Okay. Campaign developments are always important. Or, for instance, you something like mark for your villains, you know, like, oh, the Silted King is a regional villain, but his source for power and the potential discoveries that he might make, making a very good candidate to become a world leader, a world of villain later on, as he after he meets the party, so on and so forth. So, yeah, and as the things develop, things change in the campaign, the keys of the Marmoreal Tomb are not supposed to stay static. You're supposed to have your own notepads once you start running the campaign and change stuff as the players explore and newcomers come to the area and so on and so forth. So as you develop that and things keep changing and all that, so from time to time, yeah, keep inserting new events, new characters, new encounters, you know, via the wandering monster table, into the game from the outside, right? So that the world keeps influencing what's going on, and keeps swarming around the PCs. And of course, the PCs, if they're doing anything worth notice, are going to affect those developments and create developments of their own. And so the thing keeps on growing and growing and having tons of stuff going on, right? And if you're doing your job right, the players will have stuff to do all the time. You know, they won't have a downtime where they're like, oh, we have nothing to do. No, but at the same time, if you keep if the players keep their camp focused and you help them in that, then you can tune out the noise and not make them feel like they have too many options. You see what I mean? Like, that's why you should throw them a bone from time to time, and things must happen so that to refocus the game. And or if really something a thread they have been digging through adventuring dies, to spring back the game to life with something new, right? So that's how you do it. So this is part of the reason why writing something like the Marmoral Tomb is complicated, because you can't write the dungeon and the wilderness around and the hex around the dungeon and whatnot. You can't write even the village, even the home base of Crom Camlock. You can't write any of those things thinking, okay, the key is it, and that will never change during the game. This is not how it's supposed to work. These things, all these components are supposed to interact with one another, right? And if you're dealing with a dungeon with five rooms, that's one thing. If you're dealing with a dungeon with 35 rooms, right? You don't have five more times the amount of work. You have 5 times 5, you have 25. But what I mean by that is that the connections, the network connections are exponential, right? So that's one thing to work from 3 maps, and another thing to work from 30 maps, which is around the number of maps that the Marmoral Tomb total with Wilderness and Underworld expansion deals with. That's to explain the kind of dynamism we're talking about, right? So this is fascinating stuff. This is super exciting. I guess, I don't know if you hear it in my voice, but at the same time, this is really something that to think about carefully. And while writing, it's important to stay concise. Do not make a huge... The intent is not for the Marmoral Tomb to end up being 400 pages. Oh my god. No, it's supposed to stay within a reasonable, say, 50 pages for the module. And likewise for the expansions, the Player's Guild is not supposed to be that big. It's supposed to be 16 pages, something like that. So, really, it's perhaps more a question of what not to write and what to actually write. So that's the thing that's right now that's what's taking me the most revisions and all that kind of stuff. But we're getting there. Anyway, I wanted to approach that topic of the sandbox. And as always, tell me what you think. You know, if you're running a sandbox yourself and you think I missed something, just comment. Or if you're curious about it, but you don't think I address something that you think I should address, likewise, tell me. And that's pretty much it. All right. So let me know and see you next time. Bye.